I'm Dr. Manvir Bhatia. I'm a senior neurologist and a sleep specialist. I live in Hoskhas, New Delhi. I was trained at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences with sleep and neurology. And I've worked in multi-speciality hospitals in Delhi. Now I have my own clinic in Hoskhas, Delhi, that's called Neurology and Sleep Center.
So you think you're working in one of the key fields of neurology, sleep?
So yes, sleep is, let's say, a budding field of neurology, and sleep has become a big focus in our lives because over the last few years, the importance of sleep is descending on the human mankind. That so far we have ignored sleep. You know, everybody talked a lot about adequate nutrition, exercise, but now we know that if you were to talk about the three pillars of health, in addition to good exercise, adequate exercise, good food, is good sleep.
And why do you think we are going through like problems with sleep nowadays?
So in fact, problems with sleep started, some people say, with the discovery of light. And then I say the second problems or the second issue started with the discovery of the connectivity, that is the nets that we have. Sleep in the initial years or before the discovery of electricity or this connectivity, it was pretty much a very simple phenomena that when it gets dark, people would end the day and the night would begin. And in the morning when the sun would rise, the day would begin. But we have changed this with our development. The night has got pushed later. So the darkness and the night don't coincide anymore. So what is it? We say that we are going against the body rhythm. And that's what is called as a delayed phase. That people are sleeping much later than ideally they should. Wake up time, because of the work pressures, it remains the same. So thus the sleep is becoming curtailed.
So this is in a city like Delhi, this is a perfect illustration for this evolution. Like the city never sleeps. It's a huge city, full of noise, full of people going to work, like transportation. Can you explain that?
So yeah, so the big cities, the metros, and Delhi being one of them, there is a continuous flow of energy. People are continuously doing things. So this could be youngsters who are, let's say, partying, or they are on their phones or mobiles and connectivity in any form. There are the people who are the corporates working as consultants, as CEOs. They are also working till late hours. And then, of course, thus the cars, the sound. So a lot of people are living very close to very busy, populated, thickly populated areas and densely infiltrated roads. So the sound becomes a big deterrent. So what do we need actually to get good sleep? We need a relaxed mind and the environment. So the environment talks about the light and the sound and of course the temperature. So Delhi also goes through a lot of changes of temperature, which are hard for the body to maintain if you do not have air conditioning all over.
Can you summarize like what are the elements that you can find in Delhi that can be a disturbance to sleep if you don't care?
So the elements in Delhi which can cause or disturbance in sleep are, one of course is sound. So a large number of people are living close to areas where there is a very much higher sound intensity than what is good for sleep. Secondly is the lights. So if the lights are on all through the night and in certain areas, they harm the internal milieu or the control of sleep. Third is the city is a mixture of youngsters, working professionals. So they have self-inflicted delays in sleep, which they have done. And the fourth is the temperature. Delhi has extremes of temperature. We will head into summer where it becomes like a boiling temperature outside, and the winter the temperatures are cooler. So if the people or the rooms are not of an adequate temperature, which is ideally about 20 to 22 degrees centigrade, it's going to interfere with the sleep quality.
So that's why like, AC is a must.
So air conditioning is a must, but air conditioning is not easy. Not majority of the people may not have air conditioning, and thus you will see that it will start disturbing their sleep.
So let's start over again, because we've been already through the problems, but like, why, like, fundamentally is it important to sleep, at least not neglect sleep, and what is correct sleep depending on the age you are?
So if we talk about sleep, it's a pretty complicated topic, but to make it simple, there are three aspects of sleep when we say what is good sleep, because invariably people ask what is good sleep. So one is the duration of sleep, which is very easy to understand. The time you sleep and the time you wake up, you calculate number of hours. For an adult, the number of hours required is 7 to 8 hours of sleep. We have extremes in children and in the elderly, but let's talk about an average adult. So that's the duration of sleep. Second issue is, or the important is, the quality of sleep. So many people have an adequate duration, but the quality is impaired. By quality, we mean that you should have ideally a different time spent in different stages of sleep. That means a light sleep, simply to put it, the deep sleep, and there is something called as a dream sleep. So thus, we should spend adequate amount of time in the deep sleep. And third is the timing, that what is the time? So a lot of people think that if they sleep at 4 a.m. and they get up at 10 or 11 a.m. or they sleep at 5 a.m. and get up at noon, it's fine. So the timing has to be right. So the three issues we talk about is the duration of sleep, the quality of sleep, and the timing of sleep.
And why is it important to sleep, like for a person's body and mind?
So sleep, just to say one word, sleep is very essential for physical health, mental health, and emotional health. So physical health, let's take. So during sleep, certain hormones are released. They are growth hormones, which are looking at the growth, of course, in children, but they are also responsible for your body repair. So people feel the skin looks better, the wrinkles are less, it's like an anti-aging. We have melatonin, which is also an anti-aging hormone. So these are certain hormones which are released. The blood pressure is maintained, the heart rate is maintained all during sleep. For emotional health, again, we can say that it's been seen now by research that if patients or people who are sleep deprived, are they more angry? So it's called as a short fuse. So is sleep deprivation why is the cause of this road rage, or why are we so angry? Because it's clearly shown by research that when sleep is less, the ability to spark is much higher. There's much more short-temperedness, as we call it. And then comes the mental health. Recent studies are all showing that sleep is a very, very important and essential component for memory, creativity, thoughts and ideas as such. So if sleep is not adequate, brain health is going to be compromised.
Can get like completely out of control.
Yeah, so sometimes I wonder that is this road rage that is happening, you know, late at night, people get very angry on the roads, they are attacking each other. Maybe there's less of sleep, because the center of anger in our body is usually suppressed with good sleep. And if the sleep is not adequate, that center is like firing away excessively.
So to get back to specifically Delhi, you were talking about eye temperature, noise, etc. But there is something that you would not expect when you don't know Indian cities, but that happens in hot cities like Delhi. Like at some point of the day, after lunchtime, things seem to stop, like to freeze somehow, even in Delhi, in a city like Delhi. Can you tell us about that? Like,
so there is this culture in India which is called as a nap culture or the siesta culture. Probably it goes with the peak in temperature, and we all of us also have what is called as a dip, that during the afternoon a time does come when the drive for sleep increases. And if you've had a very rich, heavy Indian meal, the two coincide together and the desire to fall asleep becomes much quicker. So people, thus you may see them in Delhi taking a short nap. So they could be the auto rickshaw drivers taking a nap. Maybe the work demand is less. the cab drivers could be in the taxis, there are some people on the streets, and regardless of the sound or the noise, etc., they are able to take a nap. These naps, now we of course know that they are also called power naps, and they have some beneficial effect on the body and the brain as well. So these naps are kind of like a rejuvenating experience. You can divide the day into two categories. The second day can start fresh again. You will feel more energetic and more rested because the brain has taken a little bit of rest and it's ready for the day again.
So this is something that is respirating in Indian culture. This is really a tradition. This is something that is linked to, I don't know, spicy food and the needs for the body.
So if you see lots of European countries as well, where the temperature goes very high, they also have a custom of the siesta. So maybe the temperatures just go very high, and if you, the body doesn't allow you to work to your full extent and your full output is not determined by that, and thus people do start taking this short rest. Also could be that if you have woken up very early and the days are very long. You see, and also another thing in Delhi, people work till very late. Versus some other parts of the country and of the world, that if you are working, like shopkeepers close shops by 10:30, 11, the people who are driving cabs or taxis are working till very late and waking up early. The middle of the day, there is a fatigue which sets in and it's a dip. So that dip then coincides and they take a nap.
And you think this is something positive that should remain, this burnout, or this is just a small compensation?
So it depends. If people do feel better and if it's like a rejuvenating experience, a small nap is now considered a good thing. But yes, if one is to sleep for 1.5 to 2 hours, then we know it's going to impact the night sleep. So short naps are beneficial.
Are there better places to sleep in? Are there better places than houses to sleep in? What do you recommend? Like, what is a good place to sleep?
Oh,
according to you,
good place to sleep. So I think it's very individual. Ideally, it should be the home, the bed where you're comfortable. That's where you would get ideal sleep. But I guess if people are at work and they are outside during the day, some people in their offices have got like a lounger. Some have a sofa cum bed. And of course, some people on the streets, you see that whenever they find a space, they will take a nap.
So there is no specific, like comfort is important?
Is it for the night sleep or day sleep?
I don't know. If there is a nuance, maybe you can explain it, because there are also auto rickshaw drivers, they never stop.
Yeah, so the sleep, see the night sleep, yes, like we talked about the environment. So in that environment is the bed, is the comfort, is the temperature. Is your mattress, is your sheet. So those are also important issues which do give you comfortable sleep. But I guess during the day, if one is at home, yes, one can take a nap in the bed, in your bedroom. But if not, then you will find a place wherever you can to take a small nap.
And the temperature, the noise environment is also something that has to be taken into consideration,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Can you repeat about the ideal temperature you were mentioning for the body?
So the ideal temperature, the room temperature for good sleep is somewhere between 20 to 22 degrees centigrade. And that's when the body is comfortable. So if it's colder than that, the sleep is not going to be very good. And if it's warmer than that, again, it's not going to be very good. So that's where the regulation works best, the homeostasis.
It gets never like that low in Delhi.
It never gets low, so you will need air conditioning to maintain that temperature.
Because you can see also people sleeping in the middle of the road, but for a reason, so that the cars flowing, we bring some air, right?
Jugaad, it's people, if you see some bridges, recently somebody explained to me that under a bridge, people find a place to sleep, but they have their own areas carved out so that when there is maximum cross ventilation, they sleep there. You know, so when the air kind of has a cooling effect. But yes, like I said, not everybody is fortunate enough to have air conditioning, so then they do get to sleep wherever they can, but it can become very hard in summer. And this will affect their day, the work, the productivity. It will get affected if the sleep is not good at night.
So you yourself are a specialist about this, like the troubles that people can face. So what kind of troubles can people face? What are the most common things that you so get through?
The commonest complaint which people have regarding sleep is poor sleep. That I don't sleep well. My sleep is not adequate. You know, that's one of the commonest ones. And if worldwide prevalence, we know that about at a given time, 30% or so are not happy with their sleep. But 10% really have what is called as an insomnia. The second complaint which comes often is that I'm just very tired and very sleepy during the day. These people are sleepy at work, sleepy while driving, they have to pull over on the side, they chew some gum, smoke a cigarette, throw water on their face and drive again. And in spite of that, people can have an accident. Sleepy during the meeting, I've heard people say that they dozed off and the colleagues could hear them like a snore. They kind of just dozed off. So it's uncontrollable desire to sleep. Sleepy in a college, sleepy in school. So this is excessive sleepiness. The third one is much lesser complaint, or less often people talk about, is sleepwalking, sleep talking, some abnormal behavior in sleep, nightmares, hitting the person next to them. So those are the lesser ones. The commonest being just very poor sleep, and second one being loud snoring, very sleepy in the daytime.
What are usually the indicators that people base themselves on to decide, okay, now I have to do something about my sleep, there's something wrong? Usually
that's interesting, because for very long, people try and handle this themselves. You know, we say that for a physical complaint, for example, if you have a fever or a headache or something, they would go faster to a doctor. For sleep-related issues, the average time before they come to a doctor is a few years, because firstly, they don't think that this is an issue which any doctor can deal with, or they have their own methods and ways to deal with it. So for example, people who have poor sleep will start reading or googling and find out what are the things that they can do. They do that. Second, they might go to a pharmacy, start taking some self-medication, and then when things don't work, I think the most important thing is when it starts affecting their day, and that's the time then they come. Similarly for snoring, they will first not admit it. They don't like to talk about snoring. Snoring is like a big taboo word. They learn to handle it, then they move out of their bedrooms, they have separate bedrooms, etc. Finally, to the point that it disturbs their own work, and when they can't focus, can't concentrate, or the children, grandchildren, somebody started telling them that something is not right, or you've had an accident, then they come. So they come to us usually when it's caused a significant impairment in their day work. And for sleep talking and sleep walking, similarly, once in a while you get up, say something, go back. But I've had children who've been found on the balconies at night, then the parents are disturbed. We've had students who walked out at night, and that's how they come for help.
So the help, what kind of help usually do you provide? Like, what are the solutions? Like, you can hear like people say, okay, you are snoring, that's because you eat too much at dinner, because you had too much drinks or something like that. Maybe you can adapt your food or adapt something to reduce whatever you can. Maybe for snoring, but
generally,
anything general.
So, first of all, we talk to the patient. You know, the sleep in any medical field, we say a history. That means we talk to the patient in great detail. Find out when the problem started, how it started, help them go back a few years. Like, suppose somebody has poor sleep, when did it really start? For children, did it, or people who are in college now, did it start in school? For women, did it start with some stress factor? Is there coexisting depression, anxiety? So we need a lot of information regarding that. Then depending upon the problem, we offer the solution. So for example, for snoring, for instance, and somebody is feeling very sleepy, we do a test which is called as a sleep test. This is an overnight test when they are monitored for snoring, breathing, brain activity, to see what is really happening. For people who have poor sleep, again, we either I get them to see a psychologist to see what else is there, to go a little deeper into the cause. So we can't treat all sleep disorders with one single pill or one single remedy. We need to go deeper and find out what's happening and then treat that.
So maybe could you specify if there is anything that concrete that could be like one of the reason we don't sleep well? Like for example, I was talking, I'm insisting about it, like the food, the way you take food, the timings.
So
this can be one of the things.
Yeah. So the type of food, the quantity of food, and the timing of food. We do know now in India and in Delhi and in all metros, in India particularly, the food, the dinner is very late. So most of the people will have dinner post 10 p.m. at night. That's one part of it. So the timing is all wrong. Secondly, because they feel that they've not had a good lunch if they are at work, they feel this should be the major meal of the day. So this meal is a very rich carbohydrate meal with lots of fat content, protein content. It's a heavy meal. So people who sleep with such a heavy meal and a late dinner, they're bound to have a lot of heartburn at night, regurgitation, snoring will get much louder, apneas will get much worse, there'll be breathing pauses, and the night sleep is going to be disturbed. So yes, food does play a very important role regarding the timing, the quantity, and what do we eat at night.
And about the rhythm of life, because like, okay, we are more and more sleep deprived, like what can we do? What would be like the areas we really have to work on, or that people should...
So if to improve sleep on the whole, we say that there are these tips which are called as the sleep hygiene tips. Some people call them the 10 commandments of good sleep or the sleep hygiene tips. Majorly, they work on just 2-3 principles, that the body should be physically tired. So with the sedentary life that we all lead now, there should be some exercise component somewhere in the day. Towards the end of the day, the mind or the brain, whatever, should start winding down. Start doing some relaxing activities near bedtime. Decrease stimulation such as caffeine, all the caffeine related drinks which are very high, like Red Bull, etc. So please restrict all those. And of course the screen time. So the biggest culprit now has become the screen time. People are not able to disconnect. So the last half an hour, 1 hour prior to sleep, screens should be off, some relaxing bedtime activity, which is relaxing for the individual, practice that, and then hopefully ensure good lighting, temperature, sound, bed comfort, and sleep should be adequate.
So you are from Delhi originally? Are you from Delhi?
I'm from many places. Okay, but now I'm from Delhi. Meaning in India, studied somewhere else, medical school somewhere else, but now in Delhi.
Okay.
For long.
So you live in Delhi, so how do you manage to follow these commandments in this city?
How do I follow it? So yes, it takes a while, but Delhi has...
Still a few green areas.
My motto has also become that if you say no to things or to others, you say yes to yourself. So Delhi's socializing activities all work very late. So if you need to be, let's say, disciplined yourself, that this is going to be my bedtime, this is the time that I will wind down, and choose a winding down routine. Similarly, for the wake up time, fix the wake up time without alarm clocks. Do some activity which either is a walk or a yoga or something which is going to relax you towards the beginning of the day or relax towards the end of the day. We've changed the timing of dinner. We moved the dinners much early. try and avoid carbohydrates at night. It's mostly a protein-based diet or a salad or a soup. So that's how kind of have made... we have kind of changed our home as is eating that. So yes, but it's hard. It's because the timings are late, the food customs are late, everything is much more delayed.
Yeah, and also like you think like the... I mean, I don't know if you've worked anywhere else than Delhi, but do you think there are clearly like symptoms that you will find higher and stronger in such kind of city?
So yes, the relationship with like, let's say the late socializing is much higher here. Social events are much in the city. If you go to smaller towns, they do wind up a lot earlier. Their meal times are earlier. Maybe they may be a little heavier meal, but it'll be earlier. And also the interactions are of a different type. You know, people would maybe spend more time talking to each other, not so much individual on screen times. But though, of course, the screen time is now infiltrating most of the country. But yes, the timings do vary. The travel time in Delhi is very high. You know, if you have to go from point A to point B, you will take anywhere between 45 minutes to an hour to hour and a half to even meet up for something. Whereas in smaller towns, you'd be, you know, 10 to 15 minutes away, so you could meet earlier, go back home earlier. So the distances have become a big issue in Delhi.
And maybe, like, for example, nowadays is Shadi season. So you can't, like, you cannot open a window without, like, I mean, maybe not in this area, but, like, you hear noise, like, there is, like,
yeah, so there are these loudspeakers which are...
It's also in India, usually, like, when there is a celebration, it has to be noisy, it has to be... But you don't have any neighborhood problems? Like, no, nobody's complaining
so
about it. In France, you shut all the area down.
Like, yeah, no, so you're right. I mean, to help with this situation, there are some laws that beyond a certain time, the loudspeakers and the noise has to be cut down. But in Delhi, you're right, it's interesting that everybody else should also participate in the celebrations. But people are coming up and they are strict now. They are reporting to the police because, see, the examinations are going on. The children are appearing for what are called as a board exam. So the parents do want something to be done. So measures are being taken. Hopefully, they'll get implemented soon.
Isn't it sad for the kids? Like, we should not go out at night late, we should not celebrate too much. Like, is it okay if it happens like once in a while, or like what kind of discipline?
So it's everything is okay if it happens in moderation and once in a while, but routinely, if one starts sleeping at 4 a.m. and getting up at noon, that's bound to be a problem. But if once in a while somebody is able to sleep a little late, get up a little late, functioning well in the day, then I think there's no problem. Most of the times it depends on how the individual's day is going. That's the most important thing, that if you feel that you're productive, bright, energetic in the day, then it's good and you can manage your work.
Maybe last question about the, we talked about the symptoms and the reason, outside reason, but who are the people who are facing problems? Do you mean different kind of profile, like anybody, like from the woman working at home to the guy working in on the road, like you were mentioning taxi drivers? I don't know.
What are the kind of people I get?
Yeah.
So I see all kinds of people, all age groups, all genders. So we see a bunch of younger people, like from 18 to 25, who are having issues with sleep because voluntarily they delayed their sleep and now they can't bring the cycle back.
What do you mean voluntarily?
Voluntarily means that they were on their screens, talking to people, listening, watching YouTube or movies, Netflix, which has become an addiction, that they stayed awake till 4 a.m., 5 a.m. Now they want to sleep at 11 and 12 and they can't. So they come seeking help for that. We have similarly people in 30s and 40s who, because of their sedentary lifestyles, have gained a lot of weight, a lot of snoring, and they are very tired and sleepy in the day, so they need help with that. I have women late 40s, 50s who have lived most of their life for the children, the husbands, and now they are all alone, and they have either sort of developed mild depression, anxiety, so the sleep is just gone. So that's a lot. Then we have the elderly, 75, 80, who have their own sleep issues. So I would say that we see people at all age groups with all kinds of problems who need a different help in a different way.
But the elderly people need less sleep, no? I mean, my grandfather so, needs 3 hours a night.
Yeah, so they need less sleep, but they're not happy with the fact that they're getting less sleep. So then they are continuously trying to get more sleep, and that's what can be harmful if they start taking sleeping pills. So they have to be then educated to the fact that, okay, this less sleep is okay for your age.
So there was a report in France about the fact that, okay, we have lost like maybe 1 hour sleep like in 50 years, which is big. And so do you think there is a problem? We should do something about it? Like, it's a general question. As a specific observer of that, do you think like we really have to, as our big cities are improving our way of life, like networks, etc., do you think there is something that has to change, or like we are going the wrong way?
So we should be aware of this and try and curtail it, because we also know with research that less than 6 hours of sleep and more than 8.5 to 9 hours of sleep are harmful for the body. So yes, it should not happen that while increasing our day or hoping that you're going to be more productive or efficient, you will actually be harming yourself. So it's like, you know, we say there's a word called a sleep need. Each individual knows what is their sleep need or should know. So as long as one is getting that much sleep, then you're fine. But on the whole, the world over, the sleep is decreasing, the duration is decreasing, which is going to be harmful for the body. So in fact, there's some sources say that there is an obesity pandemic which is coming, or is there. So is obesity linked to sleep issues? So the sleep is getting curtailed, obesity is increasing, and we do know the relationship between sleep and weight. So, you know, other things will start increasing, the health issues will crop up. So better is just to make sure that we sleep well. Sleep the adequate amount. Yeah, lot will become again excessive sleep. So we should sleep the amount that the body needs. Don't deprive yourself of sleep.
Okay, it means that every individual is different.
Every individual is different. So we have a range. Range can be anywhere between 7 to 8.5 hours. So if somebody needs 7, that's fine. If somebody needs 8, should get 8. Not 6 and not 5.
Okay. Julien?
Okay. Est-ce que tu vois une question? Est-ce que tu veux faire le truc de face ou d'abord les cutaways?
De face, je sais plus si c'est de face. Maybe,
par précaution.
Par précaution.
Elle a déjà fait une présentation en me regardant.
Tout était bon. Elle a fait une
présentation. Ouais, je pense. Yeah. Mais du coup, si elle en refait une.
Can you introduce again yourself?
Okay.
En regardant la caméra ou en me regardant?
Non. First, you don't see the camera. And second one, you will do again, sorry.
No.
From the camera.
So you can be a bit shorter, like a bit more sensitive than the first time you did it.
Okay, just 2 lines, okay.
So first, you'll do it again with me.
Uh-huh.
And then you're doing facing the camera.
Same thing.
Yeah, exactly the same.
Okay.
I'm recording.
I'm Dr. Manvir Bhatia, a senior neurologist and a sleep specialist. Now working in Delhi for the last 25 years.
Let's try that. Voilà.
Very lucky the temperature is just okay. The next.
Okay. So she looks inside the lens or somewhere?
From the camera. Like that.
Okay. Whenever you're ready.
I'm Dr. Manvir Bhatia, a senior neurologist and a sleep specialist working in Delhi for the last 25 years.
One more in case.
I'm Dr. Manvir Bhatia, a senior neurologist and a sleep specialist working in Delhi for the last 25 years.
about it. Like I said, for some lot of time, people don't know what to do about it. And the specialists in this country, as world over, the sleep specialists are few in number. What the specialty is?
Is there a way to treat people?
The machine they use, you know about it, for snoring and stuff. Yeah, so we were helping them with that. So there is a world sleep day, which is called 15th of March, which we just finished. So I just create awareness about this. Give talks to the public, to the parents and stuff.
Massages in Ayurveda, and a lot of my patients then enroll, not here, I don't use them, but they enroll somewhere, which it helps them. That's the Ayurveda. Yoga is very good. Yoga has a certain number of what are called as asanas. Asanas, you know, are physical postures which are good for helping sleep. So we do get a yoga teacher off and on, and I tell the people, patients, to learn. Yoga also has exercises for the muscles of the throat, which helps in snoring. So that's what yoga and the Ayurveda, how they work. There are also some herbs which are there, which help in promoting good sleep. So in some things like, you know, a glass of milk is good at night and stuff like that. So these are some general measures that we do.
One question, Julien, est-ce que tu as une caméra qui est en fonction là, completely related to what you have just said, but maybe we can wrap you up in a different way. Like, in India, there is, like, people without knowing it are quite aware of health and health treatment. Like, you have Ayurveda that is in food, like this type of food. People know without knowing. Same for yoga. So, I mean, do you think this is something that is not that far from people's concern in India? I think people can understand this very easily, especially here.
Yeah, I think you're right. So we have, like, turmeric has been part of our food for ages. Ginger has been part of our food for ages. So it's gradually come over the years, but we may not know the benefit. Similarly, yoga has been or is now more available to a lot of people. So a lot of people like to hear this kind of suggestions, and they accept it more readily when we add it to the other techniques or solutions that we offer. So yes, I do add some form of yogic breathing to the people who are snoring, the pranayams and the ujjayi, which definitely helps in the strengthening the muscles, and it decreases the intensity of snoring. There are some techniques for relaxation at night which are called as the shavasana, which is a very good form of relaxation. It helps sleep. So we can, or there are available certain techniques in yoga and Ayurveda which do help in good quality sleep.
So all of this is complementary, like is a big complementary?
Yes, it's a complementary, yes. So we do not have maybe some lot of, you know, worldwide literature or research, but we do know that it works, and people are definitely feeling a lot better with it.
And from your side, like as a doctor, so you are using some specific equipment to detect the problems. You are doing treatment also,
yes.
Doing proper medical treatment.
Yes. So we do the treatment. The problem, like I said, we do something called as a sleep study or a sleep test. For the treatment, there are these machines which are like air blowers or give air under pressure. They are worn with the mask, and they control the snoring, the breathing pauses. They help the person feel more alert in the daytime and decrease blood pressure, stroke risk, etc. So I deal with that also, and teach the patients how to use it.
Moi je finis avec mes questions. Je viens, mais je vais demander là pour comment je transfère les fichiers.
Oui. Mm.
And the edited version.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Then somebody will manage to edit.
Then they will pick up whatever little clips we can and use smaller portions as well, instead of using the whole thing.
Okay, so with she'll your assistant will.
Yeah, she'll do a bit.
Probably see them. Okay. Good. Julien.
Putain, je suis droit, putain.